I think we did an example on periodic systems and we completed periodic vibration of systems under periodic functions, right? We did that CAM problem, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh yeah.
So let's see where we are. Let's do again a quick summary. We have been talking about, we discussed free vibration, right? So we learned about free vibration of undamped systems and then damped systems. Then we started the coverage on forced vibration. We studied harmonically excited systems, both undamped and damped, right? Last time we discussed periodic vibration, which is a special case, right, of harmonic, because it basically comes down to an infinite sum of harmonic functions. So today we are going to start a new topic, which really lays out foundation for some important concepts such as response spectrum and so on. So general forcing functions. So the response of the system under a general load. In other words, this is the system we have. By now, we know that this, although this may be a very simple, innocent looking model, but if you present any kind of a system in the world that you can think of, right? Now you're an expert to convert any mechanical structural system to this model, right? So what happens, so this is what we're going to study now. What happens if the load or the forcing function that acts on this mass is of a general form, not harmonic, periodic, anything you can imagine, except that we're not talking, of course, about random vibration. That in itself is a course or two courses. So this is the forcing function you have, okay, as a function of time. So how do we find the response of that system under the action of gravity like this? The approach we undertake, in fact, we can solve the problem in two ways. One, by using what we call the concept of convolution, which I'm sure you don't want that. And the other approach is based on Duhamel integral, which is the same concept in an easier, more simpler way to understand, okay? So how do we do this? Let's just think of this force as a series of tiny little forces, right, with short duration of time. In other words, this force can be thought of as the integral sum of these little forces, right? Each of them would look like this. In other words, at any instant of time, say tau, consider this differential force, which has a duration d tau, and its magnitude obviously would be f of tau. So if, first of all, we need to introduce or remind you of two terminologies. One was impulse loading. Okay. Impulse loading is a force applied with a short duration. That's called impulse loading, okay? An impulse itself is what? Impulse means the magnitude of that impulse loading times its duration. First, let me remind you of the fact that the whole course has been laid on the foundation or based on the assumption that we're dealing with, obviously, linear systems. So, what is a linear system? A linear system is what? A system that principle of superposition applies, right? In other words, the displacement do not exceed the linear range. So, not just in vibration, but any mechanical or structural system, if you're dealing with a linear system, if the system is subjected to a series of loads, you can find the response, for instance, the displacement, deflection, moment, whatever, of that structure under the action of these loads to be the sum of the action or the response of that structure due to each individual load. In other words, if you have a beam like this, right, and you had these forces acting on this beam, you wanted to find its deflection, or the moment, or the stresses. Doesn't matter. You can consider these individual problems, right? Okay? If you find the displacement of this beam under this load, this load, this load, this load, and this load, and add them up, right? That'll give you the response of the beam under the action of all these loads combined. This was called the principle of superposition. So we are going to use the same concept here because we are dealing with a linear system. But before doing that, let's look at this problem this way. If you have an impulse load that is acted on that system, what does an impulse mean? Impulse, going back to some basics or fundamentals from the physics, you remember an impulse causes a change in the momentum. In fact, the generalized form or generalized way of expressing the second law of mechanics, and you can see that I am intentionally avoiding the name Newton, right? The second law of mechanics.
Why are you avoiding the name Newton?
Because I like him so much. He was, as I told you, he was one of the biggest thieves of all time. He didn't do anything. Galileo did all of that, but he got the credit. But anyway, right. Like Tesla, who did all that work, and Thomas Newton got all the credit for, right? So,
Thomas Edison.
Yes, Thomas Edison. Right. There are two of them. Thomas Edison and Isaac Newton. Two of the most wonderful thieves of all time. But anyway, so that's why. Second law of mechanics, which states rate of change of momentum of a mass is equal to the applied force. This is the same thing as saying that force is equal to mass times the acceleration, especially if the mass is independent of time. Okay, because you can write this as this, basically F of tau is basically this. But we are, that's not what we are interested. What we are interested is that a basically, an impulse means that a change in the momentum in the system takes place. And what does that mean? That means that you can, if the mass is constant, you can write this in this way, f of tau d tau over m is equal to d of u dot. But what does this mean? That means an impulse acting on a system causes a sudden change in the velocity. So that's the meaning of it. What is this sudden change in the velocity? That means you have a system at rest, right? And you apply suddenly a force to it, right? It generates an instantaneous velocity. So the problem then reduced down to a free vibration problem. In other words, as if you've had a system which has been at rest, and the effect of this impulse loading is that it just induces an initial velocity. Or in other words, this is the problem that we are now solving. This is the problem with the initial conditions being that initial displacement is zero, but the initial velocity is f of tau d tau over m. We already know how to solve this problem. We did that, what, over a month ago. And what was the solution? The solution of a freely vibrating system due to initial conditions, right? As a function of initial conditions. So this was the general form of that. This was the general form of that response. If you had a damped system, and of course, considering the underdamped system, U of T was this, was this can basically could be written in this form. In terms of the initial conditions, could be written as this. Cos as zeta, omega n, over omega d, sine of omega d t plus cosine omega d t u naught, initial displacement, plus, okay, sine omega d t over omega d u dot naught. This was the response of a system due to initial conditions, an underdamped system. In this case, we only have velocity, in other words, in terms of the initial conditions. The initial displacement is zero, so we don't have this term. This is zero. So this part doesn't come into the picture. Therefore, U of T would be simply E minus zeta omega n T, okay, times sine omega d divided by omega d, okay, T times, this is that f of tau d tau m. So I can rewrite this then. This becomes then f of tau, okay, d tau over m e to the minus zeta omega n t sine of omega d t, okay, and I will bring omega d here, okay, t. So what is this then? What is it that we have done? What we are saying is, if I can summarize it, is this, that you have a system like this, and I am not going to put this here now. You had a system like this, a time equal to tau, you induce an initial velocity as a result of this impulse, right? So at this time, right here, you induce an initial velocity, and the system begins to vibrating, and that displacement is this, right? So if you want to find, the response of this system at some point here, say at any time, here, t minus tau, in other words, this is t, at tau, you apply that initial velocity, starts responding, the response follows this function. So if you want to find this value of this function at this time, you just substitute t minus tau into that equation, which is this equation, right? So instead of t, you have specific value of that. So that becomes u of t becomes f of tau d tau over m omega d e to the minus zeta omega n t minus tau times sine of omega d t minus tau, okay? That is then the response of that system due to action of an impulse at any time here, right? Now let's go back to the concept of superposition. We have infinite number of these applied, right? For every single one of those, this is the response, right? So in order to find the total response of the system, meaning under the action of all these impulses combined, then the total response would be simply the integral from zero to a t time, and any time, right, of that function. I take the constant terms out, which is m omega d, you have f of tau, okay, e to the minus zeta omega n, t minus tau, sine, okay, omega d, t minus tau, d tau. So this is the response of an undamped, underdamped system under the action of a general forcing function, okay, due to the action of a general forcing function acting on the system. This is called or referred to as the Duhamel integral. Obviously, this is for the case of a damped system, and the special case is when zeta is equal to zero, that means this part becomes equal to one, right? So therefore, and this becomes omega n, this becomes omega n. So the special case for an undamped system would look even easier. M over omega n integral from zero to t of f tau sine omega n t minus tau d tau. This is, yes?
So since we started with the underdamped equation?
Yeah, and it's still
works,
under.
It only works for underdamped systems?
This expression, yes.
Oh, I didn't see this.
Right, right. If you want, you can divide it for the even overdamped as well. by following the same concept. If you look at the response of an overdamped system due to initial conditions. But as we by now know, the case of underdamped is the most common type of problem to come across and the most useful one. We don't care about overdamped or critically damped systems. Okay, this is a very powerful approach because it enables you to find now the response of the system, any mechanical or structural system, or any kind of loading. For instance, impact load, blast load, I mean, you just name it. I mean, you can have an impulse, I mean, impact loading, you can have a blast loading, you can have a ramp loading, you know, have slime loading, it doesn't matter. Any kind of loading, or even generalized loading, right? Because you can do this, solve this problem numerically, do the numerical integration to find the response like this. So we are gonna do quite a few problems and examples which demonstrate the application of this. Okay, any questions? So let's start with one example problem, which is something that you already know the answer to it, but you don't know why you were told, and that is the case of impact load. So what is an impact load? The impact load is sometimes mistakenly assumed to be a static load, right? Impact load is what? You assume you have a, let's say, look at that heavy equipment, right? If you put that here on this table would deflect or develop some stresses due to the weight of that equipment, right? You know that, you've seen it in your machine design course, that if you draw that, which is an impact load, you have to consider a dynamic load factor of 2. And you accepted that. So we're gonna do an example problem where that dynamic load factor come from. And that is by using the Hamilton integral and solving the problem, that vibration problem. Of course, we're assuming that no energy loss takes place due to that impact. So I'm just going to do that one problem because in the other sections, for some reason, we have fallen a little bit behind. And so I'm just gonna do one example problem so that we can catch up with the other sections. So this is the example. We start with a simple problem of a special case. We have an undamped system, and then all of a sudden, this undamped system is subjected to a load like this. This is not a static load. It's a load that is applied at some point of time. Okay, and it stays on the system. Okay. So if the first step in writing, in solving the problem, of course, obviously, you set up the normal integral, which in this case is what? 1 over m omega n 0 to t f of tau sine omega n t minus tau d tau. You need to set up your forcing function f of tau. Okay? If you want to just look at this problem as just a pure mathematics problem, this is what it is. That tau is a dummy variable, right, in your integration. So you perform this integration based on the assumption that t is a constant value and tau is your dummy variable. So when you perform the integration, you evaluate that from 0 to t, so you end up with a function of time, that is the response of the system. So the first step is you set up F of tau. F of tau. F of tau is zero when time is less than zero, and it is F naught when time is greater than zero. Okay? And of course, the integration is done from zero to t, so we don't care about this part. So in this case, the integral would be very easy. Would be 1 over m omega n, integral from 0 to t, f of tau was f0 is a constant, sine of omega n t minus tau d tau. So f0 comes out of the integral, so u of t then would be f0 over m omega n times that integral from 0 to t of sine t minus tau d tau omega n. So you take it, integral of sine omega n, which is 1 minus over 1 over omega n, so it would be f0 over m omega n, okay, times 1 over omega n cosine of t, cosine of omega n t minus tau evaluated from 0 to t. So omega n is constant, so it comes out of that, so we have m omega n squared, and you start, of course, this from at the t to at the end, 0 would be, if you evaluate that, becomes 1 minus cosine of omega n t, okay? Because cosine of, would be cosine of 0 minus cosine of omega n t, right? Cosine of 0 is 1, so that's what results. So this is the response of a single degree of freedom undamped system under the action of an impact load. So what would be the maximum value of this response? First of all, if you look at this, omega n squared is what? K over m, right? So u of t, you can write that as f0 over k times 1 minus cosine omega nt, right? What is f0 over k? It's the static load, right? I call that w static. In other words, if f0 was assumed to be just a static load, this would be the displacement, right? But this displacement is amplified by this, right? What is the maximum value that this function can take? 1 minus cosine.
2.
2, because cosine would be 1 or negative 1. With 1, of course, with 0, so the maximum value would be 2. So maximum dynamic displacement due to an impact load is 2 times the corresponding static displacement. This is that factor called dynamic load factor that in Shakley you were told when you're dealing with impact load, use a dynamic load factor of 2. And you thought of that as a fudge factor, right? That's where it comes from, okay? Based on the assumption, the system is undamped. If the system is damped, it's a different story. Okay? If the system is undamped, that would be the dynamic load factor. In fact, we can do this problem for the case of a damped system as well. But let's, as I said, let's leave doing more example problems and more discussions on dual integral for Monday. So Friday's off, you're gonna work on your projects, and Monday you're going to deliver a nice product, and we're ahead of the schedule. In fact, we just covered Monday topic, which was general forcing function. So we are 2 days ahead of the schedule. We'll see where we go. Maybe we'll cover more materials on multi-degree of freedom system, which would be nice. And we will have, what, 3 more weeks left after that, right? Which is nice. Okay. Any questions? Great. If not, I'll see you on Monday.